Hello, my name is Roshni Kakaya, and along with Dr. Anita Nelson, I am the co-author of the article titled Prevention of Unintended Pregnancy Among Sexually Active Adolescents in the United States. Our article unpacks the conundrum of why, even though adolescent pregnancy and birth rates in the U.S. have declined dramatically from their peaks in 1991, still remain much higher than other developed countries. To give you a bit of background regarding the reproductive health choices of adolescents, in the U.S., the rates of adolescent pregnancy, abortion, and birth remain almost 7 times higher than other developed countries, even after all the developments have been made in the recent years. The good news is that the birth rates of U.S. adolescents have declined by 59% since its peak in 1991. However, we cannot ignore the fact that 91% of pregnancies in women between the ages of 15 to 17 are unintended, as well as 77% of pregnancies in women between the ages of 18 to 19. As medical providers, caring for adolescents means that it is our job to know whether our patients are sexually active and what measures they are taking to protect themselves from sexually transmitted infections and pregnancy. In one retrospective study by Goyal, published in the Journal of Pediatrics, he found that out of 1,000 visits to primary care physicians, only 212 documented that a sexual history had been taken, which speaks to a huge lack of information that adolescents, especially if they are sexually active, are getting. In our article, we detail recent trends in adolescent sexuality, including sexual activity and use of contraception. We also go over the U.S. medical criteria for contraceptive use, answering the overarching question, who can get contraception? Overall, these recommendations actually uncoupled well women visit requirements from services needed to provide women with different methods of contraception, hoping to reduce some of the barriers in accessing contraception. These recommendations are method specific, and I highly recommend going through them yourself if you are a medical provider counseling contraception to your patients. We also discuss the American Congress of Obstetricians and Gynecologists and the American Academy of Pediatrics endorsement of LARCs, long-acting reversible contraceptives, as first-line contraceptives for adolescents who decide to be sexually active. Our article includes some insights into young women's attitudes about contraception from various focus groups, which may help providers better counsel their patients. Lastly, we cover method-specific suggestions for contraceptive success with teens. We discuss implants, IUDs, injections, pills, patches, rings, barrier, behavior methods, and emergency contraception. In conclusion, we discuss that comprehensive contraceptive counseling, especially for teens, should include abstinence as an effective way to prevent sexually transmitted infections in pregnancy. However, for adolescent women who do decide to be sexually active, implants and IUDs should be treated as default first-line options. Better understanding of adolescent thought processes may help shape messages that can better motivate younger women to delay sexual activity until they are prepared to protect themselves from pregnancy and STIs, and to use contraception correctly and consistently when they become sexually active until they are prepared for pregnancy and parenthood. This is just a little snapshot of all our article has to offer, and I hope that this has given you some new and/or helpful insight. Thank you for watching.